Where they're sitting. You guys see everything upside down. Here you see everything right side up, and they see maybe the most important piece here. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
We call this the Dionysus or Dionysus house because of the imagery that we have in the heart of this mosaic that relates to the life of the god of wine, Dionysus of Dionysus. How do we know? It's got scriptures in Greek that actually tell us what's taking place through all the panels. Okay, I'll say it again for those who aren't paying attention. We call this the Dionysus or Dionysus house because of this mosaic, that most of it is giving us different scenes from the life, mythological life of the role of the goddess of the god of wine, okay, which is Dionysus. Having said that, see the lady over there in front of you? The screen up, disappeared. She is on the margins. Guys, look down below. The first margin, you see a woman. Look very carefully at the lady. Look very carefully at the lady. You can see the blush on her face. You can see the sweat under her lip. And she's looking at us at every angle. She's looking at me. She's looking at you. She's looking at you. Look at her. In Israel, we call her the Mona Lisa of the Galilee. Because Mona Lisa, right, looks at you from every angle. Yes, yes. Okay. So, where are we now? Guys, we are in what was a huge villa, a huge private home, huge even by today's standards, that was more than one floor. The section we're looking down here is just the dining area. It's the combination of dining room and living room, known as a triclinium. Triclinium. Tri-tri means three, cline, couches. Look again at the mosaic, and you'll notice that on the margins we have three parts here that are just white on black. You see what I'm saying? Look at my hand. Directly below me here, okay? And over there, we don't see the tree. We see a shape here, which in your vantage point looks like a U, from my vantage point looks like a Chet, okay? And what you would have on each of these one, two, bed, three are couches, which people would recline on. Left, okay, left. While they're having a feast here. This is called a triclinium, okay? By the way, in Hebrew today, triclin. Triclin is not, it's not Hebrew. Okay, it's penetrating into the Hebrew. Now, in the central panel, and I don't know how much you guys can see it up where you are, what you have here is a drinking contest between Dionysus or Dionysus on the right, and Hercules, another lesser god, on the left. How do we know that? Above Hercules, it says in Greek, Hercules. And above Dionysus, it says Dio, and it's cut off. And we know the rest of the Dionysus, it's definitely him. And in this drinking contest, look at me. I'm looking on from my vantage point. That's why later you guys have to come over here. From my vantage point, Dionysus is like this. Look, he drank his wine, and he turned it over. Look, like this, like I'm finished. Okay, and Hercules, look at me, is falling down, and is being supported, okay, that staff. He's like teetering, telling, whoa, I can't hold my hat. In other words, Dionysus wins the drinking contest over here in the center. Around this central panel are scenes from Greek mythology relating to the life of Dionysus. To summarize, what you're looking at here is clearly, patently, a very pagan mosaic, in a very large, like my home, well, not rich, but even whatever, a combination dining room, living room, this is large even in Israel of the 21st century. And it's just the central part. There are rooms all over it. This is a very large villa. It's on the top of the mountain here, which means whoever lived here was either the richest or one of the richest people of this town. What is the dating of this mosaic? Around the year 200 CE. It's 1,800 years old. And the lady you see over there, and by the way, you have her on the other side as well, but her face is cut off. Guys, if you look at the margin, you see where the late Mona Lisa here is below a panel, below another panel? If you go on the other side of the drinking contest, you have a power now, and you have another lady whose top part is broken off, and the bottom part is similar to here. But let's go back to Mona Lisa here. The level of artistry here is on a global level for 1,800 years ago. Those one of the best artists in antiquity worked on this mosaic, because look at this lady. In fact, you see the rouge on her face. You have about 50 different colors of tiny rocks making up just her face. You know what we call that in English in the 21st century? Megapixels. I'm not kidding. Remember, the more pixels, the sharper the picture, the more, the smaller rocks, the sharper the image. Look how perfect that image is from 1,800 years ago. So whoever owned this place and commissioned the artist took one of the best artists of their time, not in this country, not in this area, but globally, to make this. So the person who's here is either super important and or very affluent. Behind, Owen, raise your hand for a second. Behind Oren, to the right of Oren, behind him, directly behind him. You don't have to go there, just listen to me, you'll look at it afterwards. There is what appears to be a toilet and a panel in ancient Greek next to the toilet. It says hygiene, which means health. You've got a toilet, a private toilet, next to this dining hall. From the top of the hill, guys, the aqueduct doesn't come in with 20 water. This gives us a sense to just how wealthy this person is. In the Talmud, it says, I'm paraphrasing, something like this. Who is a rich man? Someone who has
a toilet
near their dining. Right. Here's the dining. Okay? Isn't that interesting?
Like the city of David.
So now, let's take this down to a big debate, an ongoing debate. Who owned and built this villa? I'll remind you that literally 20 meters from here, we have lots of mikvahot. We have a Jewish neighborhood. We're adjacent to a Jewish neighborhood at the top of the hill. The year is 200. The wealthiest Jew in this city is Rabbi Judah, the prince, the patriarch, the head of the Jewish community, the head of the Sanhedrin, the guy who's going to edit, redact, and publish the Mishnah. We're also told in the Talmud that he has a personal relationship with the emperor himself. We're also told that he owns slaves, that he has relations with non-Jews, business relations, personal relations with non-Jews. So, what's the big debate about? On the one side of the debate is, this must have been owned by either the Roman governor, okay, or a very important Roman or pagan individual living here, who was either very important politically, or was very, very wealthy, because of the hardcore pagan iconography imagery we have here in Israel. But on the other side of the debate is, this may have been either Rabbi Judah, the prince's private home, or another Hellenized affluent Jew, not him. And the argument on that side is, and this takes us back to the synagogue, which is 200 years, 250 years later than this, that we're now in a period of time where the icons, the pagan iconography, is not threatening to Judaism. So we go back to this question of, how can we have a synagogue or any Jewish art that's showing human or animal imagery when the second commandment of the Ten Commandments is fairly clear that you're not allowed to do it? The big debate in Judaism from day one is how to interpret this verse. Do we interpret it by saying absolutely no statues or imagery of human beings or animals? Or do we focus on the second half, which is don't worship them, don't bow down to them, and don't pray to them? In the Talmud, we have a famous story of Rabbi Gamliel, who is the most important rabbi of his era, and he's in a bathhouse in Akko. And he's approached by a pagan who says, how can you be using this bathhouse that has a statue of the goddess of love, Aphrodite? Anybody here know how he responds? Anybody know the story? How Rabbi Gamliel responds to this challenge from a pagan?
It wasn't there first. It was first at that house, and then they came there on.
No, that's not exactly it. He says, says, did I enter into its presence or enter into my presence? Meaning, and then says, I'll say it in nice terms, I urinate beneath this goddess of love, meaning this to me is not, I don't believe in gods and goddesses, I believe in one God, and this has no meaning to me. In other words, if the head of the Jewish community, Rabbi Gamliel, has no problem entering into what's clearly a pagan institution, the bathhouse, that has also pagan idols, gods and goddesses, and feels comfortable to do that, it gives us a roadmap to understand that this part of Jewish history, and then we have all of these pavements, mosaic pavements of synagogues with all kinds of human and animal imagery, and even pagan imagery, Judaism doesn't feel threatened by the pagan imagery. It is art, and they can actually use that for a Jewish meaning, okay, as opposed to a pagan meaning. Owen.
I just want to add one very quick thing. In the Jerusalem Talmud that was edited a century after this floor was put here, we have two sayings in two separate locations, I'm just adding them together. One that says that in the days of Rabbi Yochanan from Tiberias, that lived at the end of the 3rd century, which means just after this was installed here, not too many miles away, in the days of Rabbi Yochanan, people painted on walls, and the rabbis weren't opposed to it, didn't stop them. And another saying is that they painted on mosaic floors, and that was also accepted, which means there is some shift. Why? One of the explanations what Javi just went into, that apparently this was no religious or theological threat at the time, but we actually have it. No, yes, people did it, and we didn't stop them from doing it.
Let me take that one sentence further, piggyback on what he said. There's a lot of debate in the Talmud whether it's okay for Jews to pray in Greek and not in Hebrew. To say the most important prayer, okay, which is giving testimony and bearing witness to the one God. Okay, Shema Yisrael. And the answer is it's okay to use Greek. Okay, at the end of the day, I'm saying this to you because it gives us a sense, what I saw this before, of the infiltration of Hellenism, Roman culture into Jewish civilization when Judaism does not feel threatened by it and can use it for its own purposes. One more thing I have to say here, which is important for all of you who are not Jewish, but also for the Jews in the room. In the Passover Seder, in the Passover feast, we have a symposium, which is kind of an ancient Greco-Roman feast, which also had philosophical discussions and debates. And in the Greco-Roman symposium, people were reclining on these kine, on these couches. In the Passover Seder, today, we use pillows, okay, and we recline on them, okay, and we even, as part of our ceremony and reading of the Haggadah, reading of the Passover narrative, we talk about the oil reclining. This idea of reclining is coming back. There are different elements of the Seder which run parallel but have a Jewish meaning to what the Greco-Romans are doing. Okay? For example, we have 4 glasses of wine, but we don't do that to get drunk. Okay? And the afikoma, which is a Greek word in Greek, is not about fooling around and doing illicit things, it's about having dessert, but dessert is not fooling around. In other words, we took a Greco-Roman model for a philosophical feast and turned it into a Jewish ritual feast that talks about morals and ethics. Okay, and this triclinium is very much kind of a roadmap to show us some of the sources of the Seder of Yadam Masudim, law reclining. Okay, clear that? Triclinium reclining.